3. On the ferry, Silk Giuliano and Jimmy O'Malley walked over to where Eddie Primble was sitting. "What the hell happened?" Silk asked.
"Yeah,"
Jimmy said.
"He run us off?"
"He did," Primble said. "He's still as good as ever. Wants me to believe he hasn't pulled the trigger. Hell, even held a gun in 3 years, but..." Primble shook his head in admiration. "He had that old man hold the gun. It was brilliant." Silk looked at Jimmy. "He ran us off, and Eddie's impressed."
"I ain't so impressed," Jimmy replied. He looked at Primble. "Is the bet still on?"
"It's still on," Primble said. "I fingered him for you, didn't I? You both get a good look at him?" "I did," Silk said. He was in his early 30s, dressed completely in black. He had christened himself Silk years ago, liking the name and all its connotations. "Smooth as silk," that's what he told women, and he also considered himself to be smooth as silk with a gun. O'Malley, on the other hand, was just the opposite. Late 20s, he was rough, crude, but effective when it came to killing. One of these men wanted to take the place of Sangster in Eddie Primble's operation, but Primble wouldn't pick one until he knew that Sangster was dead and was not coming back. So a wager was put in place between Silk and Jimmy. Whichever man managed to kill Sangster would get his spot. The other man would be relegated to second banana. And neither man wanted that. "So," Primble said, "you both know him on sight. The rest is up to you." Silk and Jimmy exchanged a look. Then Silk asked, "Are you sure you didn't talk him into coming back?"
"Yeah,"
Jimmy said.
"Maybe you told him about us."
"He says he's done with it," Primble said. "If he's truly finished, I can't have him running around out here alive. Not with what he knows. No, he didn't agree to come back. He's your target, boys. And there's a lot at stake."
"He didn't look so tough," O'Malley said.
"Don't underestimate him," Primble said. "That's the only advice I'm going to give you both." "I'm not going to underestimate him," Silk said. "What's the point of killing him if he's not the best?" "Oh, he was the best, all right," Primble said. "The best I ever saw. Probably still is." "We'll see about that," Silk said, looking back at Algiers. For want of something else to say, Jimmy O'Malley said,
"Yeah."
4. It had taken Sangster a year to get to know Ken Burke well enough to tell him the truth. As a retired lawman, Burke didn't approve of the way Sangster had made his living, but as a man who had done his own share of killing, all in the line of duty, of course, he understood a man finding redemption. As a Christian, he forgave Sangster, and their friendship grew stronger after that. They didn't finish their chess game after walking Primble to the ferry. Sangster told the old man he had some thinking to do.
"About leaving?"
"Maybe."
"That'd be a shame."
"I know," Sangster said. "I love it here." He loved the house in Algiers, but he also loved the French Quarter and everything it had to offer, from its great bookstores to its countless musical venues, its food and its women.
"And don't let that fellow ruin it."
"There's only one way I could be sure of that, Burke."
"By killing him?"
Sangster nodded. "And I'm not going to do that."
"Gotta be another way, then."
"That's what I'm gonna think about."
"Well, give me a shout if you need me," Burke said. "I got guns that I know will shoot."
"I'll keep that in mind." "Thanks, Ken." After his neighbor left, Sangster walked to one of the front windows and stared out. He had known someone would find him sooner or later, but he'd hoped it wouldn't be his old boss, Primble. Now he was either going to have to deal with the man, take care of him, or move on and make a new life somewhere else. The only problem with the third one was he knew Primble wouldn't stop looking. He had too much invested in Sangster just to let him go. And if he could find him,
or have him found once, he could do it again. The problem with the second option was that he didn't kill anymore. So the only option left to him was number one, deal with him. From his vantage point, he could see his mailbox, one of those big metal ones mounted on a pole and fitted with a red flag. When the flag was up, something was in the box. The flag had not been up in the 3 years he'd been living there because nobody knew where he was to send him mail. He didn't even get junk mail because he'd instructed the post office never to deliver it. Then why was the flag up now? He went out the front door and down the walk to the mailbox. He saw that the door was slightly ajar. He hadn't thought about things like booby traps and tripwires for over 2 years. The first year, he'd kept expecting to find death around every corner, but eventually he was able to relax and start living a normal life. Not again, because he couldn't remember when he'd actually lived a normal life. Certainly not growing up. How normal could it have been to constantly be trying to avoid your parents in your own house? And certainly not since he'd killed his first man at 15, so surely it had been only the past 2 years that he could call his life normal, by conventional means. Now, as he stared at the mailbox, he had to summon back some of those old instincts. He examined the pole and the box on the outside, then used his fingers to search for wires of any kind. Finally, after pressing his ear to the box and listening intently, he eased the door open and looked inside. There was one single brown letter-sized envelope inside. He studied the interior of the box for several seconds before reaching in to remove it. Now that he was holding it, he had to be concerned that it might be a letter bomb. How could he have existed all those years having to deal with this kind of fear every moment? He ran his finger over the envelope carefully before slipping his thumb under the flap and unsealing it. It came open rather easily, indicating it hadn't been sealed very long ago. Inside was a single piece of white paper with two handwritten lines on it. "I'm at the Lafitte House, if you want to talk." It was signed E.P. He folded the note and put it back in the envelope. As he turned to go back to the house, he swiped at the red flag to put it back down. As it came down, it made a connection with a wire and a puff of smoke leaped into the air. Sangster took one step away from the box and watched the smoke rise and dissipate. Primble's sense of humor. He just wanted to show Sangster that he could be dead at that moment. Instead of going back to his house, he walked across to Burke's. "What are you going to do?" Burke asked. "I'll have to handle it somehow," Sangster said. "You think he's here to kill you?" "I think he was here to get me back," Sangster said. "Failing that, he'll have me killed."
"Not kill you himself?"
"No," Sangster said. "Primble doesn't kill. He has others do that for him."
"Like you?"
"Yes," Sangster said. "Like me. At one time." They were seated in Burke's kitchen, each with a blackened voodoo beer bottle in front of them. It was early, but they both thought the occasion called for it.
"He said he had guns with him," Burke said.
"I believe him."
"How many?"
"At least two."
"And you plan on taking them out?"
"Not if I can help it." Burke leaned back and regarded his friend across the table.
"You said you don't kill for a living anymore."
"That's right."
"How about to survive?" Burke asked. "Could you kill then?"
Sangster stared at his beer bottle. "I don't know, Burke," he said. "Are you a religious man?"
"No,"
Burke said, with no explanation. "Do you believe men have souls?" Sangster asked. "Souls that tell them what's right and what's wrong? Souls that make them feel compassion?"
"You're confusing a soul with a conscience, son," Burke said. "I know you told me you woke up 3 years ago and discovered you had both, but maybe it was just one."
"Which one?"
"That's for you to figure out. If you decide it's a soul,
then you might not want to put any black marks on it. But if you decide it's a conscience, well, you can kill and still have a conscience.
Am I kidding myself, Burke? Sangster asked. A hitman is all I've ever been. Can I be a hitman who won't kill?
A hitman is what you used to be, son, Burke said. Just like a cop is what I used to be.
You're still a cop, you old coot, Sangster said. You've told me that 100 times.
Have I?
Burke asked.
Then who is the one kidding themselves?